When you hear a show tune from the Great White Way, does a shiver run through you? Well, we're giving them to you. Sing hallelujah and shout hooray. Come on along and listen to Broadway to Main Street, USA.
There are some men with lofty goals who are also simple souls. And one of them was a giant of the American musical theater. And that, of course, was Oscar Hammerstein II. Hello, this is Larry Maslon, your host for Broadway to Main Street here on 88.3 WLIW-FM, Long Island's only signature, one-of-a-kind NPR station emanating out of Southampton northwards to southern Connecticut and westward almost up to Nassau County. Well, that beautiful voice was the one, the only Irene Dunne, of whom I imagine we'll talk a little bit about. And the song was The Folks Who Live on the Hill, music by Jerome Kern, lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein, from the unforgettable movie, which you've all seen, High, Wide, and Handsome, which I don't even think, I think they released it on DVD for about 3 seconds. But to the point, the reason we are here today is to celebrate one of the most astonishing pieces of musical theater scholarship I have ever come across. And that is my dear friend, Mark Eden Horowitz's amazing book, The Letters of Oscar Hammerstein, which has just come out virtually and will come out in print, I believe, in the summer. Yes, Mark?
End of June, first week of July.
Well, you'll want to get that as a present for your Christmas Hanukkah present already. You'll get it for your Tu B'Shvat present. Mark is, what's your, the senior curator at the Library of Congress?
I am senior music specialist in the music division at the Library of Congress.
And besides being a longtime friend for many years, we go back a long ways and we even go forward. There is no one who has written about musical theater in the last 20, 30 years who has not been helped immeasurably by Mark's expertise and a fine eye for detail. So, Mark, welcome to Broadway to Main Street.
I blushingly thank you.
I can see you blushing over Zoom. So, Mark, this is more than 1,000 pages, right?
Unfortunately, yes, or fortunately.
So it's not really a book. It's a weapon on top of everything else. But
I was shocked when it turned out to be that long. I really did not think it would be. But.
And how many, so that's around 1,000 letters out of how many in the collection at the Library of Congress?
I'm going to estimate about 15,000 letters. I transcribed in their entirety 4,500 letters.
Unbelievable.
And then out of that, I selected about 1,000 for the book.
Wow. And you've annotated them and edited them and done all this remarkable contextual stuff. Let me ask you, as someone who's always loved musical theater, who clearly knows Oscar Hammerstein, knew Oscar Hammerstein's body of work, what was the biggest surprise for you when you put all of this together?
What a good person he was. It's an understatement. I feel changed as a human being by having read his letters. I feel like he makes me want to be a better person because of the model that he set. I didn't realize how passionate he was about certain social issues. I knew he was involved in problems with race relations, but I'd never even heard of the United World Federalists before, mm-hmm. So that was entirely new to me. Sondheim had said things over the years about how people sort of misview Hammerstein as something of a hayseed, and this shows how sophisticated he really was. I mean, he studied theater and history and politics and economics. And I mean, he was a pretty erudite fellow and very well informed about so many things.
Well, it's interesting that some showbiz folks, I imagine like Cole Porter, are very good at showbiz. And then some showbiz folks, maybe Howard Dietz is a good example, are good at, or Moss Hart, or good at world events. And Oscar seemed to have an incredible savvy for both. I mean, for me, someone who's written about Oscar Hammerstein many times, I'm just knocked out by his theatrical barometer, the way he can walk into a show out of town, or the way he can read someone's script, or the way he can evaluate source material and have this laser-like acuity for what's, in his opinion, right. And usually he is right. And we'll get to some of those examples as we go on. Let's work our way through some of this musically. I believe you said that The Folks Who Live on the Hill that we just heard was his favorite or one of his favorite things that he ever wrote?
I think it's his favorite unknown piece, or it is the one piece that he has stated more than once that is a favorite that he wished were more popular and better known.
Well, it's better known in my house, I tell you that much. I mean, and it also sums up some of his ethos. I think that's one thing that you point out, that this was an era, again, Moss Hart, Irving Berlin, Cole Porter, certainly Dick Rogers, a very cosmopolitan universe. And in one of the many, 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 many ways, he was different from Rogers' previous partner, Larry Hart, who was, you know, Mr. New York City. Oscar did a kind of volte face midway through his life and became a very happy country squire in Bucks County. And it influenced his work.
I mean, that was one of the other surprises. I knew he lived on Highland Farm, but I didn't realize the degree to which it was an actual working farm. and how interested he was in its running, including the breeding of cattle.
Mm-hmm.
And
which probably stand like statues.
Exactly. And clearly it was a source of great comfort and recharging of batteries for him.
There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. The corn is as high as an elephant's eye, and it looks like it's climbing clear up to the sky. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful feeling, and everything's going my way. All the cattle are standing like statues. All the cattle are standing like statues. They don't turn their heads when they see me ride by, but a little brown maverick is winking her eye. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful feeling, everything. All the sounds of the earth are like music. The breeze is so busy, it don't miss a tree. And old weeping willow is laughing at me. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day.
That's the old man I don't like to be. What does he care if the world's got troubles? What does he care if the land ain't free? You sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. Tote that barge, lift that bale, get a little drunk, and you land in jail. But I keep laughing instead of crying. I must keep fighting until I'm dying, and old man River, he just keeps rolling along.
So, Mark, that's Old Man River, a song so wrapped and woven into the American psyche that some people think that Kern and Hammerstein just stole a folk song and stuck it in the show. But nothing could be further from the truth. And he writes about the origin of this with a letter with, I guess, certainly a great supporting player and someone who I just find hilarious, his longtime friend and lawyer, Howard Reinheimer. Yeah.
Yes.
So talk about this phrase, Old Man River, which Reinheimer actually gets wrong in your letter, right? He puts a D in, but very clearly it's Old apostrophe Man River.
Well, to that issue, one of the funny things about the letters that drove me crazy for the longest time is there were all these typos that made no sense to me. You know, how is it possible that Oscar in a letter wouldn't know that showboat is two words instead of one, or that the Schuberts are, you know, SH as opposed to SCH and all that. And finally, I realized so many letters were dictated and the secretaries are the ones who made the mistakes. And clearly things weren't always proofed.
Mm-hmm.
So I think Reinheimer's mistake was probably not really his, but whoever was taking his dictation.
All right.
But that's an aside. Apparently they, somebody was talking about doing a movie, Old Man River or Old Man River, and Oscar was investigating the possibility of sort of stopping it for copyright infringement. And his friend and lawyer, Howard Reinheimer, sends him a letter saying, you know, this is a very difficult battle to fight. And, you know, on top of which, it's not like you really invented the phrase. And Oscar very defensively, you know, says, well, as far as I know, I am the person who came up with the idea of naming the Mississippi Old Man River. No one else that I'm aware of had come up with it before.
Not even Edna Ferber. It doesn't even appear in the source material, really.
Yeah.
And so that's a nice, wonderful bookend to that famous anecdote that I guess Dorothy Hammerstein was at a party and somebody said, oh, you know, I just love Jerome Kern's Old Man River. And Dorothy said, no, Jerome Kern wrote da, 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 da. My husband wrote Old Man River.
Exactly.
So
I'll tell you also, we have a wonderful letter from Kern where he talks about the inspiration musically for Old Man River. And he says, no small part of it was inspired by hearing Paul Robeson's speaking voice in the play Black Boy in Mamaroneck, New Jersey.
Wow.
Yeah.
How fascinating. I know that when I was doing the Library of America showboat text, there is a 1926 revision. I mean, it took them a while to, I think, figure out Act Two, and I don't think they ever really figured out Act Two. But at one point, I think Captain Andy and Gaylord or something, they're old men now sitting on a riverboat looking out at the water and said, whatever happened to Joe? Whatever happened to him, that wonderful stevedore? And we saw in Act One. And they said, oh, you know, he died, whatever. He has a grandson. And that grandson is Paul Robeson. And he's performing tonight at Carnegie Hall. And then there was an In One where Paul Robeson would come out and sing something from the stage of Carnegie Hall, which they kind of wisely got rid of. That was sort of meta theater before it was even invented.
Well, one of the surprises was that for a brief moment, they talked about doing a sequel to Showboat, which I also had no idea was an idea anyone had ever had. So,
wow. Well, two of the voices that are, to me, in many ways so different and obviously bookend Oscar's career are Jerome Kern and Richard Rodgers. And, you know, in reading your wonderful anthology of letters, you can't help but sort of not cast them, but figure them as supporting players in the saga of this man's life. But they're so different. And Kern's letters are so jovial and witty and erudite in a puckish sort of way. And Rodgers, frankly, is almost all business. He's always reporting on the box office receipts or so-and-so missed the high G and something wonderful, or Yul Brynner isn't singing a puzzlement again. What do we do? And you really get a vast difference on obviously they were not completely different, because we know Rodgers adored Kern. But as personality,
Hammerstein adored Kern.
Pardon?
You mean Hammerstein?
Well, I mean, Rodgers was influenced by Kern very much. I mean, they're not completely different people the way, say, Larry Hart and Oscar Hammerstein were. Did you have any thoughts about when you started to see a shift? Certainly in the late 30s, early 40s, there's a lot of Jerome Kern in your book. And then he obviously passes away. But then you get a lot of Richard Rodgers, especially in the late 50s. You get a sense of what those two men, what their voices are for you as you edited the book?
It's interesting. I'd always wondered about Kern's persona before I started this project. I'd never had a good handle on what he was like. I couldn't have described him. So it was wonderful seeing so many letters from him. And he really did start coming alive to me. And he was, as you say, he's such an interesting combination of erudite and down to earth, a little crude sometimes, but he writes beautifully, and it's just an odd match sometimes. And clearly they were incredibly close, but you can also see how Kern was a fairly judgmental fellow, and you would not want to be on his bad side. Mm-hmm. He's fairly biting about some other people.
Arms will hold you, and some.
Rogers, I think the thing that surprised me is that he signed all his letters to Oscar Love, which I didn't expect.
Interesting.
I'd heard everything you'd said, and they don't have the same warmth, but I feel like Rogers is trying. He wants it to be there and perhaps doesn't attain it. But certainly I get the respect between them.
But they were both fairly diplomatically clear that Rogers and Hammerstein weren't going on fishing trips together and stuff like that. I mean, they had a very strong professional relationship and less of a personal relationship.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, let's go to a point with Jerome Kern where Oscar had quite a downside to his career. And it was inspired, unfortunately, I suppose you might say, by world events. So here's a very rare recording from Oscar, who never sang his own songs at cabarets and things, but reciting one from the Ed Sullivan Show.
What Ed's told you is pretty near the whole story. I hadn't written a hit in 11 years. But the only thing that really cast me down was this failure I didn't write, The Fall of Paris. I just couldn't get it out of my mind. I kept thinking of the silly and frivolous side of Paris. Chevalier in his straw hat slanting down over his eye. Miss Danguette and her famous legs. These things seemed ridiculous and pathetic and touching when you realize that the heavy boots of the enemy were stamping down on the streets of Paris. Then my mind switched from the nightlife of Paris to the more important day life. The beauty of its buildings, its trees and lawns and parks. The stimulating confusion of the happy streets. I didn't know if I'd ever see Paris again, so I tried to sketch a little picture of the city as I'd known it, to preserve the memory for myself and anyone else who cared about it as I did.
I'm going to ask Oscar to tell you the tender lyrics he wrote on that occasion for the last time I saw Paris.
A lady known as Paris, romantic and charming, has left her old companions and faded from view. Lonely men with lonely eyes are seeking her in vain. Her streets are where they were, but there's no sign of her. She has left the Seine. The last time I saw Paris, her heart was warm and gay. I heard the laughter of her heart in every street cafe. The last time I saw Paris, her trees were dressed for spring, and lovers walked beneath those trees, and birds found songs to sing. I dodged the same old taxicabs that I had dodged for years. The chorus of their squeaky horns was music to my ears. The last time I saw Paris, her heart was warm and gay. No matter how they change her, I'll remember her that way.
That was Oscar Hammerstein, one of the only two times I know of that he ever recited his lyrics to music from the Ed Sullivan Show. This is Larry Maslon, your host for Broadway to Main Street. I'm here with Mark Eden Horowitz, whose book, The Letters of Oscar Hammerstein, should be owned by everyone and anyone who loves the musical theater. One thing about Oscar that clearly was an influence on someone like Sondheim, let alone people like Sheldon Harnick, Fred Ebb, the next generation, was his attention to detail and his sense of if it's worth doing, it's worth doing right in a way that I think someone like, say, Cole Porter was a lot more whimsical about and Irving Berlin was probably a lot more general about, frankly. Talk about June is busting out all over.
There was a backers audition And Oscar gets a letter afterwards from a fellow who is a potential angel, who writes a very nice letter, but wants Oscar to know that, to the best of his knowledge, sheep don't mate in June, and which would undercut a lyric of Oscar's. Oscar writes back very lovely and thanks him for correcting him, and will address the issue. However, he doesn't. The lyric remains, although I'm trying to remember the details, but apparently this was also raised to him by someone else later, and Oscar is purported to have said something like, perhaps in normal years they do not mate at this time, but in my world in Maine in the year of
1878,
they happen to make an exception. Right.
March went out like a lion, a whipping up the water in the bay. Then April cried and stepped aside, and along come pretty little May. May was full of promises, but she didn't keep them quick enough for some. And a crowd of doubting Thomases was predicting that the summer'd never come.
Well, it's coming, my gum, you can feel it come. You can feel it in your heart, you can see it in the ground.
You can hear it in the trees, you can smell it in the breeze.
June is busting out all over, all over the meadow and the hill. Buds are busting out of bushes, and the romping river pushes every little wheel that wheels beside a mill.
June is busting out all over.
The feeling is getting so intense that the young Virginia creepers have been hugging the bejeepers out of all the morning glories on the fence. Because it's June.
Junior and my sister's even loonier, and my ma is getting kittenish with Pap.
Two ladies, the men are paying court. Lots of ships are kept at anchor just because the captains hanker for a comfort they can only get in port.
Because it's you.
So that sort of brings me to another point. Unlike other people in show business, certainly my hero, George S. Kaufman, You get the sense that Oscar doesn't suffer fools gladly, but he doesn't. He's got a wonderful diplomatic way about running around people. He certainly has no shyness about asserting his opinion. And one of the people, you really get the feeling that he's kind of in love with and also rolls his eyes about, is Edna Ferber, who sort of runs through the book as another supporting character. Because Edna's always kvetching about one thing or another or one performance, or there's a wonderful sequence, which I'm not going to give away, where she claims Oscar stole something that he put in Oklahoma from her book So Big. But how do you feel about the way he treated other people when he was in conflict with them?
Nobody was better at using honey mixed with their vinegar in, you see how manipulative Oscar is in a very kind, clever way, usually. It's interesting. His greatest ire seems to be directed to feeling that lyricists and librettists don't get the credit that they should. And that's one of the themes throughout the book. You see, he sort of, his back gets up when it's always, there's one theater that's like a summer theater, and they're doing, I think, 5 shows that summer, all of which have his lyrics. And every show is credited to the composer, you know, Jerome Kern's Showboat,
Dick Rogers' Carousel.
Yeah, whatever it was. And in a very nice but very pointed way, Oscar makes the point that this is not right. And he does, it gets under his skin, and you can see over the years, he increasingly loses patience about it. One of the things that surprised me is the first time Rogers approaches Oscar about collaborating was not for Oklahoma, but was for a potential musical version of Ferber's Saratoga Trunk, and very quickly backs off from that because of realizing how uncomfortable it will be working with Edna.
Wow. So you've actually brought me to a segue that I would have saved a little later, but why not? You know, one thing I think that historians of any kind, certainly theater historians, love is what if. There's a Marvel television show, What If? And the real, like, nuggets in the stream here of pure gold are these projects that either he thought of or someone came to him that turned out, he rejected for whatever reason, but turned out to be shows. Saratoga was eventually done quite badly by Harold Arlen and Johnny Mercer. There's Fanny, which he and Rogers turned down, that Josh Logan did with Harold Rome. But we all know that. But there's even Baker Street. There's some Conan Doyle's daughter comes to him about a Sherlock Holmes musical.
Son.
Can't imagine. And Tevye's Daughters, which is a weird thing. Ian Albert, someone offers him a Victoria, Queen Victoria musical idea. And the one that I thought was fascinating, which I didn't know, is some guy out of the blue says, if you ever thought of doing a musical that has a happy ending, and then on alternate nights you do the same show but with an unhappy ending. And you can see he's really intrigued by that, but it's sort of out of his wheelhouse. And that, of course, is Edwin Drood. Decades before Rupert Holmes wrote that. So I'm just yakking on, but the one thing I would love for you to clear up for posterity is Pygmalion.
Well, people have long said that Rogers and Hammerstein were known to have considered turning Pygmalion into a musical. And the legend is that they gave up because they couldn't figure out how to do it. I can't swear that that's not what happened, but I don't believe that's what happened. There's no evidence that they actually began any kind of work on it whatsoever. And presumably, based on what I've seen in the Hammerstein collection, there should have been evidence if Oscar had begun any kind of libretto or sketch or notes or anything like that. And there's no evidence of that. And based on the correspondence, it seems like the problem was the fellow who owned the rights that they were negotiating with was proving so difficult and demanding, they didn't want to work with him.
As Gabriel Pascal.
Gabriel Pascal, exactly.
Well, that's, go ahead.
And fortunately, he died before Lerner and Lowe got to...
Had to roll up their sleeves and deal with him. Yeah. Yeah, that's always been an eternal question, because in Lerner's autobiography, he says that he went to an Adlai Stevenson rally in New York in, I guess that would have been 1952. And Oscar said, "Wow, I hear you're taking a whack at Pygmalion. Dick and I tried and we couldn't get anywhere with it." So Alan J. Lerner was not the most accurate memoirist, but that's an interesting aspect to that story.
My sense is Lerner should be taken with quite a spoonful of sugar. Mm-hmm.
I would say an entire salt mine. Okay. Let me get back to something that you mentioned earlier about Oscar's social conscience, which was, you know, huge among his songwriting peers. And people tend to forget that between Oklahoma, biggest hit anybody ever had up to that time, and Carousel, which was not so bad either, was Carmen Jones. And that was a big hit and got a lot of attention. And there's something that really breaks my heart. Three quarters of the way into your collection of letters, where maybe it's Billy Rose writes him and says, "Oh, these people, they're doing a Carmen Jones and it's so bad. And could we please withdraw it? It's hurting the integrity of the property. If people see it, they won't want to see it again, blah, blah, blah." And of course, Carmen Jones is an all black cast, which was, you know, along with Porgy and Bess and St. Louis Woman, kind of rare between the wars. And Hammerstein says, "Yeah, I agree. But it's so hard for these, whatever he says, these actors, in other words, black actors, to get work, that I just want them to do the job and sell seats and get a salary and we'll discuss it next year." And I just thought that was so specific and so attuned to his understanding of how difficult it was for black performers to get work mid-century on Broadway in the commercial theater.
I'm touched that you made that connection and saw that. Yeah.
Pretty incredible. Well, let's hear two songs, one from the film of Carmen Jones, which you mentioned in a footnote, shockingly, between the moment they had the idea to the box office release was like 10 months or something extraordinary, right?
I don't know how that happened. Yeah.
Wow. It happened very well. So here is the film company of Carmen Jones. You'll hear Pearl Bailey and Diane Carroll, and then we'll go to another extremely important song in terms of Oscar Hammerstein's ethos.
Gonna make a trip on a crack Chicago train.
Well, that's a trip you ought to make.
It won't be hard for you to take.
Travel about as fast as a Kansas hurricane.
It only takes a half a day to be 1,000 miles away.
Away,
come on,
away,
come on,
away,
come on,
away.
Let's leave my dear time, won't delay.
Away,
come on,
away,
come on,
away,
away,
come on,
away,
come on.
That's streamlining time, won't delay.
That streamlining giant just can't wait. That streamlining giant ain't no freight. That streamlining giant won't be late.
Whizzing away along the track, clickety-clack, clickety-clack, leaving the wind away and back, clickety-clack, clickety-clack.
Up the hill and down the hill and out upon the plains again.
Through the storm and under the storm and pretty soon it rains again.
Only takes a half a day to be 1,000 miles away.
It only takes a half a day to be 1,000 miles away, away.
Come on, go away!
Chicago, Chicago, come on, away, come on, away, hey!
Back your dad. Ain't got much time.
Carmen will come.
I knew she would.
Well, let's get going.
Wait, let me say my say. If you're busting to go, then go. But just call me out at a party. Just call me out. Cause I ain't in.
Oh, Carmen, honey, have a heart.
Don't want no part of it, don't want no part of it, don't want no part.
Don't waste our time with
it all is fun.
Don't want a part of it, don't want a part of it, don't want a part.
What you got that you like so much better than this?
What you got?
What you got?
What you got?
What you got?
If I told you, you'd only laugh.
Oh, no.
Not me.
Go on.
Give out.
You gotta promise not to laugh.
Okay.
Okay.
There's a man I'm crazy for.
Isn't that a man she's crazy for?
That's why she can't come to Chicago.
That's a laugh.
Well, shut my mouth and call me dumb.
And beat me, I'm a kettle drum.
The birdies in the trees are humming. Commons in love, commons in love. Still we ask, won't you come? And break your gate, give the gate to your chum.
Another night I might have come to raise some pandemonium. But now the birds are humming, commons in love, commons in love. Leave me here with my Joe and take your train to Chicago and go.
We gotta get you on that train
some other time.
What makes you think there'll be another time?
What makes you think there'll be another time
to get a trip,
to get a trip
to Illinois,
to Illinois,
and get it free,
and get it free?
That is the place that I'd sure like to see.
Whizzing away along the track, clickety-clack, clickety-clack, leaving the wind away and back, clickety-clack, clickety-clack, up the hill and down the hill and out upon the plains again, through the storm and out the storm, and pretty soon it rains again. Only takes a half a day to be a thousand miles away. It only takes a half a day to be a thousand miles away, away.
I'm on the way.
Chicago, Chicago.
You've got to be taught to hate and fear. You've got to be taught from year to year. Why, it's got to be drummed in your dear little ear. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught to be afraid of people whose eyes are oddly made and people whose skin is a different shade. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught before it's too late, before you are six or seven or eight, to hate all the people your relatives hate. Why, you've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be carefully taught.
That was Sammy Davis Jr., the first Black performer to sing Carefully Taught, otherwise known as You've Got to Be Carefully Taught, from South Pacific. Do you think it's safe to say, Mark, that when Rodgers and Hammerstein and Josh Logan, inspired by James Michener, decided to write a song midway through the second act about racial tolerance in 1949, nothing like that had ever really appeared in the commercial American musical?
Absolutely. And it certainly raised some hackles. And there are letters to Hammerstein where people complain about it. And his responses, I think, are pretty touching and pretty telling. And the fact that he responds to total strangers about it, I think it says something about him, too.
Well, this is Larry Maslon, your host for Broadway to Main Street, and we've had this amazing hour with Mark Eden Horowitz, the senior music specialist at the Library of Congress, about his extraordinary volume, The Letters of Oscar Hammerstein, due out at the end of June, even as we speak, by Oxford University Press. And there's so much more to talk about Oscar that we're actually going to move into a second hour next week. Next Sunday at 3 o'clock, we will pick up with Sondheim and Rogers and lots of interesting people and, of course, lots of fantastic songs. There is a lot going on with Oscar Hammerstein. There is, in Bucks County, where he had his wonderful country home, the Oscar Hammerstein Museum and Theater Education Center, ginning up. If you want to know more about it, go to www.hammersteinmuseum.org. And on July 11th, they are going to have a concert called The Sound of Hammerstein, trying to raise money for this wonderful institution hosted by our good pal, Ted Chapin. But we will stop here for now, and we will see you next week. And courtesy of Oscar Hammerstein and Harry Ruby, we will give you a song to build a dream on, A Kiss to Build a Dream On, sung by the wonderful Louis Armstrong. So we'll see you next week for more Oscar Hammerstein.
Give me a kiss to build a dream on, and my imagination will thrive upon that kiss. Sweetheart, I ask no more than this, a kiss to build a dream on. Give me a kiss before you leave me, and my imagination will feed my hungry heart. Leave me one thing before we part, a kiss to build a dream on. When I'm alone with my fancies, I'll be with you, weaving romances, making believe they're true. Oh, give me your lips for just a moment, and my imagination will make that moment live. Give me what you alone can give, a kiss to build a dream on.
Is the time all gone to? This is Larry Maslon here at Broadway to Main Street. Let's catch up next Sunday at 3:00.